All right, so as far as I can tell, we should be ready. Just give us a quick second for those of you that may or may not be viewing this. We're just getting a couple little details set up, and then we should be ready. So let me just do a quick refresh on this. The image here looks like it's live. And I know we have a few folks that have joined, so let's do a quick double check to see if that's playing.
Your name is Corbin. Oh, you should go.
All right, so give us a second while we play with this. So as far as I can tell, it is streaming, and it should be on YouTube as well. So, perfect. All right, and Carolyn, do you have a chance to get Gaurav involved as well?
Yeah, you should see him there. He looks like a helper screen.
Let me just bring this up here. Oh, perfect. So we're all good. All right. Well, at this point, then, I guess we might as well get started. So for those of you, it's a little disorienting here knowing that there are people who may be watching on YouTube, and I think the session is being recorded as well. So that's part of our goal, so that folks can view it after the event is done. So just by way of a quick hello, then folks that are joining, welcome here. We're still in the process of getting a few little details ironed out and a couple little glitches taken care of just with the process. Hangouts is a wonderful tool, but unfortunately Hangouts is sometimes a bit confusing because of the windows in which it launches and doesn't give you a dedicated URL readily. And so we've got those things worked out now. What we want to do today, really, just give you an introduction to what this course is, talk a little bit about some of the innovations that we're going to be doing. We're going to attempt another session next week, Tuesday, that'll flesh out additional innovations, and then we'll go from there. But before we dive into too much, I just want to do some quick intros. So I'm George Seaman, so I've been involved in developing this MOOC, and we'll spend some time to talking about the kinds of things that we're going to be doing over the next little while. And the first 2 weeks, I'll spend some time with you. And then we have Dragon, Carolyn, and Ryan Baker. Ryan's in an airplane en route to China, so he won't be joining us. But I'm just going to throw it over to Carolyn for just a quick hello, then Dragon, then Matt, and then we can get started with a few of the things we'd like to address today.
Great. Hi there. I'm Carolyn Rosé from Carnegie Mellon, and I'm here with two of my excellent graduate students who have been involved in getting us all ready for this. And I'll be teaching the text mining portion of the course, also supporting some of the interventions that we're offering.
Thanks, Carolyn. Dragon, who are you?
Hello, everybody. My name is Dragon Gashuch. I am from Athabasca University, based in Vancouver. Today, I'm joining from beautiful Texas, Arlington, visiting the University of Texas, Arlington here. I will be responsible for a session related to social network analysis and also certain work related to the social general experience and different social media technologies that we are going to use throughout the course. There will be a dedicated portion of today's introduction about the specific platform that we are piloting throughout this course, as well as several other additional social media technologies and approaches that we are trying to use and play with in this particular course. George, over to you.
Yeah, and Matt, yeah, let's just a quick hello from you as well.
Yeah, hello. My name is Matt Crossland. I'm with the Link Lab, and I'll be serving as an instructional designer for this MOOC.
All right. Well, thanks for the quick introductions there. There's a couple things that we want to do now, is just give you a sense of what it is that we'd like to do differently over the duration of this this MOOC. And one of the things that we would like to emphasize in particular is just the opportunity for individuals to begin thinking analytically, if you will, about the way that we look at data and educational data. And a particular opportunity to do that is obviously to spend some time working with a series of the tools and getting a better sense of what are we borrowing from other fields in terms of analytic practice, what are we seeing emerge as native to the analytic space, in learning analytics specifically. And so what I mean with that is that there are certain tools that fill a role in research that we've used traditionally in educational settings, but those are changing in some regard as learning analytics and educational data mining become a little bit more sophisticated as individual fields as well. And we're starting to see the development of some approaches for making sense of data that's generated in educational context that is reflective of some of the topics we'll be looking at over the next 9 weeks of the course. And so as you're going through, you'll get a chance to explore some different options. You'll get a chance to look at different technologies. We're going to start fairly light by engaging with you around a tool set called Tableau, which is a fairly easy and a fairly accessible tool set, meaning that it's not an overwhelmingly difficult tool to begin working with. And because of that, we thought it'd be a comfortable introduction into what you may be able to do with analytics. Now, it has some limitations, which is why we are looking at a range of additional tools. One of the limitations with Tableau is that it has, or it lacks some of the discourse analysis functionality that we're going to use as we move throughout the course. So we'll address those details a little bit later on. Specifically, in terms of innovations, we are using a range of technologies that we'll get into in a little bit, and Dragon will talk about software that will look from a distributed perspective. Carolyn will talk about some interventions that come out of her lab, and that's generated a fair bit of interest and excitement from the folks at edX in general, because it's a fairly innovative approach to group and support help. In terms of expectations, I should mention as well that we think, or at least I'll maybe perhaps speak a little more for myself, I think that in the MOOC landscape, we too prematurely settled on the instructional model that we have. And we really want to take an opportunity with this course to ask a lot of questions and experiment with a range of different ways of making learning happen in different contexts. And so we are experimenting with social learning. We're experimenting with different support structures that help you in your learning process. We're also experimenting with completely different types of software than what you've perhaps used in the past, which will help to drive the engagement process with other learners and also to give you, hopefully, a better opportunity of engaging with course content. As a result of those experiments, we expect that there'll be a few glitches here and there, and we're very willing to listen to feedback and experiences that you have. So as we get a little bit further along, and you'll see this in your Sunday night email, we'll provide you with a link to share feedback on the tools that you're using or any glitches that you encounter so that we can make sure we continue to prove and innovate. Beyond that, there's a visual syllabus, which you will also have shared in the email that goes out. I'll tweet it out in a few minutes once I turn things over here in a bit. But we'll also share out some of the examples that Matt's been working on with the visual syllabus, which gives a fairly nice centering space for you to get a sense of what's been happening, what's going on in different conversation spaces, and what does that mean to each of us as we start to engage in the course. So what I mean with that specifically is that once you when you have a fragmented course like this that's distributed across different spaces, the opportunity for you to quickly go to a set page and see the lay of the land is quite valuable. And you'll see all of the tools are set, all of the are listed there, ways to download and ways to start working with it. Help resources will be listed there, the different tags that we're using on different social media is listed, additional readings if you want to dive deeper into some of the weekly subject areas. So everything is listed there. And I'll tweet that out as soon as I'm done with this quick overview. At this point, I'd like to turn the conversation over to Matt just to add any additional thoughts related to the structure of the syllabus or the resource pages and some of the things that individuals can expect going forward.
Well, the visual syllabus is really just designed to hopefully be a little bit more user-friendly. When you go to it, you'll see that there are easily numbered steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. You can just go through those in those order or not. You can skip ahead if you want to. You'll find a map of kind of the way the tools work together. You'll be able to click on different areas on that to get more details. We've also included a social learning guide for those that want to dive into social learning, want to do more connectivism type stuff. You can dive in with that, as well as other resources page, a list of all the tools. If you ever just run into a place in the class where it's like, I don't know what to do here. It's talking about this program. What do? You can go to the all tools page and you'll find a list of everything we're using from Twitter to Facebook to Tableau and EFB and RapidMiner and everything. And you'll also find a calendar in there that will list all the events, the upcoming Hangouts, the activities, the week that we're on. And so hopefully it'll be a helpful resource, as well as once the course gets going, people start blogging and tweeting. ProSolo is going to collect a lot of that, and Dragon's going to talk a lot about that later, but you'll find a quick link to your daily summary page of what's happening, as well as a quick link to the Twitter feed for the DALMOOC hashtag. And so hope that it'll be a good resource. And if you ever have any questions on it, please feel free to contact us. And we'll love to answer any questions you have. So back to George.
Great, thanks very much. So Carolyn, at this point, one of the things that we're quite excited about, and as I mentioned, there's been interest certainly within Annex broadly as a platform as well as some of the work that Carolyn's been doing, and one of the reasons why I was certainly eager to start working with her is some of the innovative activities around group work and providing help-seeking support for learners in a course. So she's going to provide a quick overview of a tool that they've developed. There'll be a couple tools that come out of Carolyn's lab, but the first one she's looking at is a helper functionality that I think will become more valuable to you as course participants as we move through the course. So Carolyn, over to you for a quick demo. All right, you're currently muted, Carolyn.
So we should be projecting the screen from Gaurav's computer. How can we make that happen? Oh, at least I can see it if I click on it.
Yes, yeah, I think everybody should see it now.
Great. Okay, so Gaurav is going to be stepping us through the Quick Helper. Let me just quickly say that this will be available from within the edX course. We are just waiting for a final network approval that should come in tomorrow. So at the moment, we're demoing this from a local instance of OpenEdX so you can see how it works. Currently, if you use this from inside of the course, what will happen is your message will be posted directly to the discussion forum, but the additional functionality that you see won't operate until we have this permission in place. So like I said, that should be tomorrow sometime. So now Gaurav is going to step us through, and I'll be kind of explaining it as he goes. What you can see here is that he's scrolled down to a place where the Quick Helper is, and if you go to that page in the course that has the Hangouts at the bottom of the page, you'll see this Quick Helper. And so now Gaurav is going to show you. He's clicking on the New Post button. So this is what you would do if you had a question and you wanted to get help. And it gives you an interface that looks just like the discussion forum interface. And now Gaurav is filling in a help request, just explaining what his question is and what he would like to have help on. So the goal of the Quick Helper is to make sure that just as it gets posted to the discussion forum, some helpers are picked out for you. So if you click that button, then it gives you the message that says, in a moment, we'll show you some fellow helpers. So now you can see that the pop-up screen that comes up, and it tells you that if you select one of the helpers from below, one or more, then an email will be sent to them with a link to a link that tells them about your help request. And that when they click on it, they can actually go and reply to you. And at the top, there's a preview of what the message will look like. And below, you can see the people who you might pick. And it'll give a little bit of information about each one. In the first week of the course, it will all be TAs from the course who will offer as helpers. But as the course continues, there will be the opportunity for students from the course also to offer help to their fellow students. So you can see here Gaurav has checked off two of those three suggested helpers, and now what will happen is that an email message will be generated to those helpers. Gaurav is showing also that there's a link that the student who posted the help request can get to the discussion forum. So if he clicks on that, then he can show where that in the discussion forum that message has been posted. That means that the student who posted can always go back there to see responses, and anyone who's rummaging around in the discussion forums can also participate. Now Gaurav is going to show what the emails look like that come. So you can see that it looks like it's coming from somebody named DALMOOC Help Request, and you can see that the help request that was posted is pasted in, but then there's also a link that the student who receives that help request can click on. Why don't you go ahead and click on that, Gaurav? To come to the thread and to participate and offer some response. So as I was saying, the goal really is to make it quicker to get help through the discussion forums. There's a big issue that people post to discussion forums, and some of those help requests just never get responded to, or appropriate helpers don't come to offer the kind of help that's needed. So this help matching intervention is meant to draw in who have the expertise in a timely fashion. So I'll turn it back over now to George.
Great. Thanks very much, Carolyn. And just so you're aware, we'll provide short tutorials on some of these details as well as we get to the course so that you know this will be part of the overall help page. So if you're on Twitter, if you just search the DALMOOC tag, I shared the visual syllabus there, but you'll get emails on this tomorrow as well. And this will help you get a sense of how to use the different tool sets, and it'll be something that we'll keep referencing during our weekly live session so you have an opportunity to get more comfortable with those elements of the course. Now, another thing that we just briefly want to look at, we're not going to go into great detail on this here, but we do have some support that it happens in the form of teaching assistants or individuals that have just offered to spend a bit of time being active in the course. You'll see them as and we'll introduce them in different sessions throughout the course. So these are just individuals that we want involved just to make sure that if you have questions and they're not getting answered quick enough, that there's somebody that's able to flag them or be able to give you a hand with those. The discussion forums, probably the best way to look at what we'll set, if you're familiar with the edX system, there's a set discussion forums that will address topics within individual weeks. Feel free to direct any help requests there or in other areas such as the quick helper that was just referenced. If you have concerns or questions that relate to the content or that relate to the videos or other factors, we'll make sure that those are shared with you as well, or at least tracked in the discussion forums. And that's a central role that the individuals that have agreed to be involved in helping the course will be playing. I think that's about it from a forums perspective, but I do want to address a second innovation now. I'll turn it over to Dragon in just a second for this, and that relates to activities that we are involved with now in the overall structure of the course. So one of the views that we've had, certainly with courses that I've run in the past and that Dragon and others have been involved with as well, is that a large part of the learning process should be about you having an opportunity to create things, create artifacts, share artifacts, and then by doing that, to teach others. So open learning, transparent learning is an act of teaching. And so we obviously prefer not to go against the spirit of the web because it's a bit of a losing bet on several levels. And so what you see with the tool sets is we expect to use a range of software that you own or that you decide you want to play in. So if you prefer to blog, blog throughout the course. There's opportunities to share. And we'll be tracking that as well. We'll talk about how to do that. If you want to use Twitter, do that as well. So these are all really a matter of your preferences. One of the things that we've done is a software that I'm turning over to Dragon now to talk about is ProSolo, which allows an integrated space for tracking and developing your competencies and sharing them socially, as well as to create a bit of an accreditation timeline, if you will. But Dragon, over to you.
Thanks, George. So probably you can see this projection that I'm making already about the whole software that we are working with. And that indicates the whole architecture of this system that George mentioned. In particular, what we are talking about here is a piece of technology that George, myself, and several other colleagues are working on for the last several years. And in that process, we are trying to emphasize the whole notion that learning happens in different networks. So in particular, what we are trying to support inside of these networks is basically a process in which learners can plan their activities, then they can document the activities and even provide the evidence for particular types of competencies perhaps they are developing throughout the course. And eventually, based on these types of competencies that they develop, they can create their profiles, present themselves to the rest of the world. However, many would say that these types of solutions somewhere exist. What happens is in many of these types of solutions is that we are often quite isolated in creating our profiles. Or our profiles are somehow disconnected from the evidence that we produced about learning experience. So that's why ProSolo has this very strong social layer. This social layer is very well connected with any other types of social media or most of the social media that you may be using with. So for example, ProSolo allows for connecting profiles of users with their RSS feeds, with their Twitter profiles, with also their blogs, but at the same time, we can also support for integration with any different types of social media that you may produce during the course, such as, for example, some slides or some videos. In this platform, you will be also able to share all this information with all your peers. At the same time, ProSolo allows for several types of recommendations, who to connect with. For example, we realized by offering different types of MOOCs that learners prefer to connect with other users who are very close to them in terms of geographic location. Therefore, if you decide to disclose your least town from which you are coming from, then you will be able to get some recommendation about people who are very close geographically to you. Of course, if you just decide not to do that, then you will not disclose that information, and thus ProSolo will not share that information nor make any recommendation based on that. Similarly, we are also allowing for recommendations that are based on the recency of the activities, given that the nature of MOOCs doesn't have full commitment of other users. Final component which makes ProSolo in a way unique is this credentialing pipeline. This credentialing pipeline, all the evidence that you produce, you will be able to share it with others and ask for assessment. However, what is the important level of that assessment is that that assessment, if you want to use that assessment, becomes public together with the information about the assessor as well as the information of the evidence that you use to generate the to support particular type of skills that you gain inside of the course. Of course, you can always control and not to share that with anybody. So ProSolo basically allows users to fully control the entire user experience. Just to give a very quick glimpse over what is inside of ProSolo, I'm going to quickly turn my screen sharing into the ProSolo, into the window where ProSolo is open, which will take just a moment, given that I have many windows. All right, so I've located it. Yeah, I'm just switching over to the new technology. So I hope that you now can see ProSolo. I think that takes time because there was just a quick moment in which I had opened things. So what I'm sharing now, it's coming through as well. I think that there's this slight delay.
Yeah, it looks like we're getting some matrix type of effect here. So I'm not sure if you want to try that again, or alternatively, as I should mention with this as well, you'll be getting emails and tutorials around how this works on Sunday night as well. So you'll get a link to the tutorial page and a way to sign up and to get involved too.
Yes, makes sense, George. I guess I was hoping that will work, but for some reason, it doesn't.
Okay, well, thanks for that introduction overview, Dragon. I think image captures a lot of what we're trying to articulate with the course. So we're seeing a few things here, just by way of quick summary, and then I'm going to turn it over to Carolyn to talk about a tool set that for group work and group activity. So, and we'll have a chance to briefly have a look at that as well, or experiment with it. So I just want to emphasize for now, at least, that there's a few things we're playing with in this course that relate to structure and lack of structure. So there will be the edX platform where you'll have an opportunity to go through a structured process of learning, but there will also be the distributed spaces where you can tweet, blog, or do whatever you like. But there will also be socially driven spaces where we're going to emphasize opportunities for you to connect in an integrated environment such as ProSolo, where you'll be able to create competencies but also build credentialing pipelines that reflect the kinds of things that you've been learning. And so it's a few of these tension points that we're finding quite interesting regarding the course structure as a whole. And what I mean with that is that these tension points give us an opportunity to look differently at what does learning at scale feel like from a user perspective. Is it an isolating one? Is it one where you don't have support handy or readily available when you need it, and a range of other concerns? So we want to try and tweak a few of those, or at least experiment to have an understanding of it. And I should mention as well that throughout this course, there'll be data that will be collected, as you can likely anticipate and have probably read from publications that have happened with regard to MOOCs. The data, of course, is handled according to IRB standards, and none of the data here involves deception or any related activities, so it's primarily just observing how learners are interacting and using the different tool sets, and how these in turn allow us to better improve the MOOC experience, or at least the online learning experience. When you get into edX, you'll have a pop-up that will give an overview of how we're intending to conduct research and the intentions of that research, and it'll give you an opportunity also to not participate. With that, though, Carolyn, I'll turn it over to you to address the group tool.
Just unmute myself. Okay. Can you hear me, and can you see that I am on the Hangout introduction page? Is that all working fine?
I can see that.
Okay, so one thing to point out is what George was just referring to is the DALMOOC course agreement. It's under course orientation, and I'd like to encourage you to go ahead and read that and respond if you so choose. And for now, what I want to talk to you about is another opportunity that you will have to be able to interact with your fellow students. There's a little description of it here where it says collaborative activity orientation. That just explains to you how these collaborative activities will work throughout the course. The idea is that in the midst of some of the assignments, you'll do first an individual portion, and then you'll have the opportunity to click and be matched to another student who you can have a discussion with. And since it's a MOOC and the hope is that there will be a critical mass of students, the hope is that when you click, there will be other students around that you could be matched with and have a conversation. So to let you know what that kind of looks like, if you scroll down on your own screen, you should be able to see this button that I'm indicating towards right now with my cursor. And if you click on that button, then what will happen is that you will enter into a lobby program. Now I'm just letting my postdoc know to go ahead and log in also, so there will be at least one other student in there. So I'm going to now log into this as Carolyn Rose. Now I'm entering in a lobby program. This lobby program is going to wait for a little while to see if other students come in and then match me. And since I have just sent a text message to my postdoc, hopefully he also clicked to enter, and the system should match us up and should give me a link that says that there's a chat room that's set up for us. So we'll just wait here for a moment. And as that's happening, I'll just let you know that what happens is that if you come and there aren't other students to match you with, after 2 minutes it'll let you know that there are no other students to talk to at the moment and that you should come back later. And it will display a visualization of over time when clicks are coming in so that you can gauge for yourself when would be a time when you're likely to get matched with another student. So you don't have to set up an appointment up front. You'll just be able to see the times that are that frequently have other students around, and you can pick one that's good for you. And if you don't end up coming back at that time, it's no problem. So we're just waiting now for that link. It should be coming any moment now. Okay, so I was matched and it should give me the link, and then all you have to do is click on this link and then you enter in to a chat room. And there will be an agent there called Virtual Carolyn who will sort of lead you through the activity. It looks like my postdoc hasn't clicked to come in yet. He should be coming in any moment now. And so the agent is encouraging us to introduce ourselves, but I'm going to wait for Oliver to come on in. Oh, but no, but somebody got matched. Somebody must have gotten matched with me and didn't click their link. Oh, okay, somebody has joined. And now I'm going to say hi. Hi, Ali. You can see, you can have an open chat. After each step in the activity, you can indicate when you think that you're ready, and then the other student gets to indicate whether they're ready as well, and then the agent comes and leads you into the next part.
And for those of you on YouTube that might not be hearing anything, it's because, and this is, so the video is a little smaller on YouTube, but right now Carolyn is just demonstrating how she's interacting with, well, herself virtually and others. So just there's some text happening off to the side that you might not be able to see on the YouTube screen.
Okay, so you can see that there were some contributions by me and some contributions by a student named Ollie, and when we were done, we clicked this We're Ready button. Another thing that I'd like to demo is that you can also paste in URLs. So let's say, for example, I wanted to share my homepage. I could do that, and then it would be accessible to me and also other students in the room. They could just click and see it. And that's one way that you can share information with other people who you're chatting with during the exercises. And once you're done, then you can just disconnect and go back to the course. So I encourage you to go ahead and click on that button. Any of you out there can go ahead and do that. My student, Gaurav, here has just told me that some of the students out there are already getting matched and having some chats, so I'm really happy to hear that. And we really look forward to being able to support your interaction during this course. And I guess I'll turn it back over to George now.
Great. Well, thanks very much, Carolyn, for that. I was busy involved in a chat in one of the with Virtual Carolyn and James. We were just getting ourselves oriented. So for those of you that are wondering, where are those links? If you log into the edX course, and you can do that now, and during the course, this is one of these things that we're going to learn about how well does it work. So one of the expectations that a lot of learners have, and this is why group work is difficult in a MOOC, because a lot of people in different time zones, different schedules, but also different rates of participation. So someone may take a MOOC just to have a look at the readings and watch a few lectures or videos, and that's it. Someone else might take a MOOC because they really want to get deep into the topic, and they're there week in and week out. So that's one of the challenges that we face, where what happens by the time you get to week 7 and you have a different cluster of students, so you can't have pre-configured groups. So this idea of spinning groups on the go is something that those of you that are, I don't know, Call of Duty players or something, you'll be familiar with, which is that you join a lobby or a space and you wait until enough people show up, and then you launch into your mission. So that's essentially what this attempts to reflect or emulate. The only thing that's, I guess, it's a chat roulette of learning with a little less nudity. So other than that, though, I think that's really essentially what we wanted to communicate with you today, a few details of the course. So if you log in now, for those of you that are interested in doing this, just log into edX, dive in, engage with the group help tool. We will also be, as I mentioned, experimenting whether we have set structured times in this, or does it work if we just leave everybody free to join whenever they want, and what happens to the system. So these are things I know that Carolyn's interested in discovering, certainly edX is as well, because this is a level of support that we need to focus on too. Anything else before we wrap up? Matt, Carolyn, Dragon.
I think we're squared away here. I'm talking to one of the students now in the chat. Someone from New Zealand. Hi out there, Rob.
See, and I have some Australia. I thought I would have to throw this out. Apparently, you win. Dragon, any final thoughts?
No, I think this is it. Unfortunately, we didn't have a chance to demo today at Pro Solo, but we are going to provide lots of different videos and demos for you to be ready, and late Sunday you will get access to there as well. Other than that, many questions, and our support will be provided throughout the course. Look forward to working with everybody.
Great, and a final point, I'll just turn over to Matt for a last comment, but one of the things, can we also see the research as participants? There's a question that came off of, I think, YouTube or Twitter or somewhere, and the short answer is that some of the data actually you'll be using to do some analytics work as you go through the course, which means that you'll be doing some of the activities will be on course data that's generated. There are some anonymization criteria that we obviously have to follow, so there's certain data that we see as an institution that we get from the system, just from the edX system, that we have to clean and anonymize. So you'll see some of the data, but obviously our first priority is to make sure that the individual participants in the course are not identified, and some other criteria that we have to function under. Matt, do you have any final comments before we wrap up?
Yes. We also have the Twitter handle. We have the Facebook page, the Google Plus page. We'll be checking on those. If you have any questions or ideas or anything you want to share, please feel free to comments or thoughts or questions there.
All right, excellent. Well, tomorrow, Matt and I are going to have just a quick conversation. It's happening. You'll get an email out on this again, but that'll just focus briefly on the design decisions, so you have a better sense of what were we thinking throughout the course, and what were some of the criteria that we wanted to have reflected in the design. We've touched on a few of those, but we'll get into more detail. On Sunday night, you're going to get the information around the course, what's happening next week. A live session is currently scheduled for Tuesday. We'll try and give you a schedule of live sessions throughout the course. One of the difficulties is with a group of folks who are traveling involved in this group. I think Carolyn's on her way out to Doha next Wednesday, so we have to have some flexibility around our travel schedules, but we certainly want to make sure that there's an opportunity for us to hear from each of you, connect with you, and have simultaneous sessions to engage you. Thanks, everyone, for being here and joining us. We're looking forward to the next 9 weeks. Take care. Have a good night or good morning or wherever you've got going on now.
Bye.